Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for inviting me to speak here, Dr. Farouk, Musa, and IRF, and also Nottingham University in KL. And it is something that I would, I don't know, I always have mixed feelings talking about these things. I wish I could have come for a better or a good, you know, bringing good news and doing a talk on something that is different than this one, because this is, of course, something that we all here, I hope, in this room, share our concern about. And so I would like to start with a little bit about Jaringan Gusdurian or Gusdurian Network in Indonesia. This is a network that has been flourishing in the last 6 years following the passing of Gusdur, of Abdurrahman Wahid, my father. He has been popularly known in Indonesia as a champion of human rights and democracy, and he was also the leader for the biggest Muslim organization in Indonesia. And of course, so he worked with minorities and people in human rights challenges situation. And because of that, when he passed away, many people started talking about how to continue his work in Indonesia, and then we decided to set up a Gusdurian network. This is the home for the Gusdurian, the people that call themselves the followers of Gusdur, and we try to continue his work in working on multiculturalism. And for the members that come from the Muslim community to work in Islam, Nusantara, and Islam, peaceful Islam in Indonesia. And because of that, we are highly exposed to these problems of religious extremism and violent extremism in Indonesia and discrimination. So I would start with one of his quotes. Here, he said that the deep problem is that people use religion wrongly in pursuit of victory and triumph. And I will show later how our findings from our mapping, internet and social media mapping on extreme narratives, narratives of extremism in Indonesia, is actually a direct message would be about pursuit of victory and triumph. Yeah. And this is what happened in Indonesia. Dr. Maryam talked about the ISIS challenge. In Indonesia, actually, we are happy to say that the risk or the opportunity for Indonesian people to join ISIS is not really that high. We have been celebrated as one of the Muslim community that has been successful in keeping the people from joining ISIS. The terrors, the use of terrors and violence, the use of terrors itself is also not really that high, considering we have 205 million Muslims in Indonesia. Indonesia has the biggest Muslim population without it being an Islamic state. So this has been contemplated as the model of how compatible Islam and democracy is for the global stage. But we have problems with rising intolerance and rising extremism. Extremism Islamism practices within the Muslim community in Indonesia. So that's two separate separate things. Terrors are not endorsed, but intolerance, how we view our relationship with other people, people of different faith or people of different groups, is getting problematic in Indonesia. So this is how I would like to portray this. We have which one is the this one? So this is the extremists. They have already managed to work with the mainstream public, which is more or less the pluralistic Muslim, the open Muslim society in Indonesia, and they have been introducing new values, new traditions, new culture of being intolerant, and of course this is also resonate with what happens in other places in the world, the so-called majoritarianism, because in Indonesia the majority is the Muslims, then some people believe that we should have privilege over others, and we should have Indonesia should put Sharia law as the formal law in Indonesia, and this campaign has been going really strong.
I would like to make a certain mention of this one, extremism.
So before the last three decades, because the this exclusivism has been getting more and more pronounced in the last three decades in Indonesia. But before that, the Indonesian people, they have been practicing Islam in more or less syncretic way. It's Islam and culture, the traditional culture of Indonesia is really, really strongly, intricated, and it has shaped the characters of the Muslims in Indonesia. In, like, for example, in Nahdlatul Ulama, the biggest Muslim organization that I come from, we uphold the principles of tawassut. This is moderatism, moderate way of life, and then tawazun, balance, tasamuh, tolerance, and i'tidal, principle of justice. So many Nahdiyins, the people from NU, they practice tolerance in a very open way. We welcome people of different religion, even to the pesantren, the so-called traditional Islamic school system. It has always been no problem. But the last few years, this practice of extremism in religious life that people usually think or celebrate as more spiritualism in Indonesia, celebrated as the growing Islamization of Indonesia. But also at the same time, it leads to extremism. So this is what we are currently facing in Indonesia, the rise of extremism. So to understand the dynamics, these conclusions I take from many surveys, latest surveys in Indonesia. So majority of the subjects in the surveys done separately over separate subjects, of course,
The majority said terror and violence are not religious. But also, the majority shows tendency to be intolerant of people of different faiths. Another research by CSIS in Indonesia asked more than 2,000 people in more than 20 cities in Indonesia whether you believe in people with a different religion. And 25% said there is no way we can believe, we can trust people from different religions. It doesn't really matter if you're good or if you have integrity. Just because you come from a different religion, then I don't trust you. But out of that 75% who chose another answer, 60% said that we should be wary and careful of people from different religion. Almost 40 people said they do not want to have people of different religion as their neighbors. That's another survey from Majalah Femina. So this tendency is getting more and more pronounced. And majority rejects radicalism, but minor proportion tend to support radical acts. Only 7% of survey from 500 people, but 7% out of 1,500 is, of course, big. More than half respondents in all these surveys said that they dislike specific groups and consider them as sesat. What is sesat? Bless. Deviant. And this one is a surprising finding, because people often said that often believe that economic situation lead people to terrorism or acts of terror and violence. No. So this is consistent from all findings that education, income, and residence, whether they live in rural or urban areas, these factors are not relevant to whether you are tolerant to others or not. Majority of the people believe that Indonesia should stay united, and Pancasila and democracy as best system and values for Indonesia. So they still reject the Islamic State idea. And the higher belief in democratic values, the lower the potential for intolerance acts. But there are certain nuances that we feel alarmed about. Like, for example, in one of the survey from Infit, people were asked whether congratulating people for their religious festivities are haram or not. For people who are 25 years of age and above, only a small percentage said that Christmas greeting is haram. But for the age group 16 to 19, 40% said, more than 40% said that it's haram. If you look at the age brackets, you will see an attitude of intolerance getting more and more increasing. So this is the mapping of violent extremism ideas on the internet. We tried to look at the narratives, because we believe that in the curve that we have I have shown you, these narratives plays a major role in bringing people to more intolerant ideas. So this is what we find. We find that the grand narratives come in two big grand ideas. One is that Islam is oppressed by the world, and the second one is purification or puritanism, the single truth that there is only one way of Islam, and this is a certain way. If you're not practicing that way, then you are not real Muslim. The key message is this world is about Muslim versus non-Muslims. You can see that this is done through web scraping from Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and also from social networking like WhatsApp groups and Telegrams. And the formats and the messages are, of course, really various, yeah. But the key messages is on this one. The world is about Muslims versus non-Muslims. Current world is Muslims or non-Muslims. So together with the single truth narrative, if you are against what I'm campaigning about, then you are non-Muslim, even though you said that you are Muslim. So this kind of beliefs has been getting really, really strong, especially the last 6 months in Indonesia. And also the other key messages is democracy is set by non-Muslims to destroy Islam. So not only democracy is not Islam, or democracy is not compatible with Islam, but now it is developed, it is created to destroy Islam by the non-Muslims. This is the message. And also the single truth, of course, in Indonesia, it's the most popular term would be on Twitter. If you post something that doesn't really, if you don't approve of what the hardliners are saying, usually you get responses like this: agama kamu apa? If you say that, oh, I don't believe that Ahok's case, the Jakarta governor case is a blasphemy, then the response would be agama kamu apa? It's as if challenging the narrative that Ahok has done a blasphemy just make you a non-Muslim, like that. Or situ Muslim, like that, in that tone. This is the single truth. Identity politics, this one, identity politics. Right now, currently in Indonesia, this is very famous, ganteng syari, handsome, in a syari way. So you have hairs like this, you have beard, and you have pants that is above your apa mata kaki?
Ankle.
This is the kind of identity politics that has been strongly campaigned in Indonesia. Yeah. This one is the single truth. Islam ya Islam, tidak ada. There is no Islam Nusantara, Islam Middle Eastern Islam, Islam Extreme, Islam Moderat. Islam is only one Islam, that is my way. So this is a campaign. This one is about the democracy. Democracy system syirik. Caution, stay Muslim, don't vote. The right of legislation is for none but Allah. But just this morning, Jai from Gusdurian Network just told me that there's also another campaign currently, because on the 15th, there would be the Jakarta election, governorial election. And the people who are campaigning against this now is calling for the Muslims to vote. Because yes, democracy is against Islam. Yes, we reject voting, but this time we need your vote. so So this is what happened in Indonesia. And call to action, the narratives, call to action, motivational frame from all this is Muslims should purify Islam. I just heard last week a comment about Nahdlatul Ulama and Muhammadiyah, two of the biggest Muslim organizations in Indonesia. So the hardliners in some groups said that NU and Muhammadiyah should be Islamized. They are not Muslims. That is currently the campaign. And Muslims should fight back the oppression, injustices, and also Muslims should conquer the world. This is the ideas that has been going strong, and everything is going into these two narratives. Everything, even whether you want to take one wife or more. So what do we make out of this this phenomenon? In Gusdurian Network, we have been exploring this theory of moral foundation theory by Jonathan Haidt, because we were trying so hard to understand the dynamics. And we find this theory to help us understand how people are appealed to this line of thinking of being oppressed, of why blasphemy, why single truth, why this attitude of religiosity that has doesn't make sense sometimes. And we find in this theory, Haidt said that people define their truth from these six modules of morality. Everyone has them. Care, a morality of caring for others. An immoral person who is an immoral person would be a person who is harming others. And there is a module of fairness and cheating, loyalty and betrayal, authority and subversion, sanctity and degradation, and liberty and oppression. And Jonathan Haidt did an online-based research on this, involving thousands of people, and come up with this conclusion that the liberals only focused on this module and this module, but the conservatives group, especially the extremist group, they tend to focus on this one. This one is the highest. But all modules are, touched by their messaging, by their narratives. So like, for example, Islam is oppressed, goes to this one, and this one, and this one, and this one. While the human rights, global human rights movement and approaches only focus on this and this. And so it's easier for the mainstream public to to be influenced by the messaging of sanctity and degradation. If you don't want to fight this morning, there's a broadcast message from in WhatsApp groups in Indonesia that calls for your AK-47 is your Android now. Your AK, AK-47, right? This machine gun. Your machine gun is your Androids. Use them for the glory of Islam. And of course, I'm talking about the extremist Islam, the Islamist in Indonesia. But these messages, you can always find them in different settings, different communities. The same messagings, the same narratives, probably done by different religious groups, different groups from religion, different background. Like for example, in Myanmar, I've been talking to the human rights groups in Myanmar. The message is the same, only the victims are different. Yeah, so this is I would actually stop this because this one is the how we try to respond to the situation, and these are what we are trying to accomplish in Indonesia right now. Yeah, so I would stop at this point, and later we can explore more in the discussion. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.